Revolution Radio proudly presents, live from Phoenix, Arizona, the Truth Deny Talk Radio with host Roxy Lopez. Join us here for topics you won't hear about on mainstream news, such as chemtrails, GMOs, nutrition, and conspiracy facts regarding your personal sovereignty. Humanity is 7 billion strong. We are the majority. And now, live from the Valley of the Sun, your host, Roxy Lopez.
And a very good evening to all of you. Thank you again for joining us. This interview this evening is going to be quite interesting. You want to strap in on it. I'll give you some information about our guest in a moment. I had quite a few stories that I wanted to share this evening, as I do for the news, but I think I'm just going to enlighten everybody to one in particular, being that it's relevant to our show. You know, I started to look into why we were having so many Skype problems or problems with the show. As you all know, you've been so patient, and I really do appreciate that from all of you, as we've had technical difficulties increasing as the year has gone by. And of course, a lot of you have told me that it's, you know, the NSA and the this and the that and blah, blah, blah. But the fact of the matter is, I mean, that's very dramatic. And I'm not closed to that. It happened on certain shows. But as I am an investigator, I sort of looked over the whole Microsoft buying out in 2011 for $8.5 billion. They purchased Skype. Now, if any of you follow the stock market or you follow how corporations work, the reason why the CEO of Microsoft, whose last name is Ballmer, B-A-L-L-M-E-R, purchased, from what I'm reading and looking into, and this is through stock reports, etc., it seems like they basically wanted to take two reasons that I'm coming across. First of all, that was way overbought. In other words, the price was just alarmingly high. Second of all, Google wanted it, and so did Apple. So when they came up with this $8.5 billion and purchased it, I guess it was a no-brainer for Skype. But it gets really interesting, because I feel that from what I have read, couldn't have it. Two, for its client list. With over 663 million subscribers, and that number goes up every day, just like the Facebook membership numbers go up every day. So think about it. The amount of money that they used to purchase it, it was very questionable whether they were actually going to pay every dime of it to Skype owners. And the other fact that Microsoft is conflicting with Skype. In other words, not with Microsoft goals. I'm talking about software conflict. Google turned around and said at some point later this year that they rather build something of their own than purchase something like Skype, which, you know, take it for what it's worth. They also mentioned, and this is interesting, Ballmer, and I'm going to quote him. He said the company can go from here either up or down. And Ballmer's fear is that the direction will be down, down, down. That's public information. This is after the acquisition, the purchase. My take on it at this point, because there's good news about Skype as well. What they can do with Skype, because apparently it was very, you know, it's a great invention, if you will. And because it has so many subscribers. But it also has conflict with Mac. And that's where Apple comes in, because I don't know, those of you who have iPhones, you know about FaceTime on your iPhones. But Apple feels that they're going to build that. And the question is whether Apple pulls a WebKit on FaceTime so that Google and Apple pull the rug from under Skype. And that's also public information. And that's being discussed based on market price of all three companies involving Skype, with three companies being Google, Apple, and Microsoft. Microsoft's shares being the lowest of the three. So it's very interesting. What does this mean to Skype? Well, if it's got conflicts, and I have been seeing hosts all over, even outside of the United States, complaining about their interface with Skype. Everybody's having problems with Skype. General users might not be having trouble with Skype, but try doing a radio show. So I thought I'd just fill you in a little bit that as much as I'd like to say our shows are very, very important and probably of some sort of interest to the NSA or Homeland Security at times, I actually think that this is a tech issue, and we'll keep an eye on the Skype story. I have a lot more to report on that, so I'll fill you guys in on future shows as well. But my guess is Microsoft wanted Skype off the market before Google or Apple could grab it. Google's going to build their own VoIP, voiceover. Apple's already in motion doing that. And so this is about a market game. This is about a corporate agenda and business as usual in the United States of America. Or should I say the United States Corporation? Anyway, thought I'd just fill you in with that tidbit. My guest this evening is Ole Dammegard, and I hope I'm pronouncing this right. His website is linked up on thetruthandi.com. If you want to go take a look at it, it's Light on Conspiracies. Amazing man. Countless interviews this man has done for the work that he has done. We're going to discuss quite a bit the strong links between the JFK, RFK, and MLK, Martin Luther King, John Lennon, Che Guevara, 9/11, Oklahoma City, Sandy Hook, etc. There are strong links between these assassinations. And we're going to discuss this. We're going to go down the line with this. Ole is an expert in this investigation. I'm very curious to hear how he discovered the links to these assassinations. I'm sure you'll all be – it's going to be a gripping show. So without any further ado, I would like to welcome my guest, Ole Dammegard. Ole, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
Amazing work that you're doing. And if I – am I pronouncing Ole? Is that correct? Is that okay?
It sounds great. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, how did you get involved in sort of connecting the dots between these once called conspiracies? And where are you from? And what is your interest in connecting the dots? What became your passion for this?
Okay, my body was born in Denmark, and I grew up in Sweden. At the moment, I live in Spain because I had to leave Sweden due to the assassination of the Swedish Prime Minister. As you know, when you start digging into these things and you keep digging, it gets a bit dangerous in the end. And I lost two friends on the way, and I felt it was getting too close, so I decided to move to Spain. But For me, I mean, at the moment, there's so many truth seekers waking up all over the globe, which is absolutely amazing. But my journey started in the early 80s with, I think the first time was really when I saw a documentary where they showed the Zapruder film for the first time. At least it was the first time I saw it. And when I noticed that the Zapruder film, if people don't know what that is, it's where the President Kennedy is being shot. And in that film, you can very clearly see that he's being shot from the front right and not from the back right, where the official story says that the sniper was sitting. And when I saw that, it was just like mind-blowing, because I thought, my God, the official story that we are being fed, it's absolutely not true. So that's got me started. I used to work as a journalist at that time, and I really got into trying to, for my own sake, understand what really happened in Dealey Plaza. And I think in the end, I read 100, 200 books, I don't know how many, but I almost became obsessed with it, because when you look into it, it's super complex and so multi-layered, this conspiracy. But while I was really looking into this and educating myself, then I also became very interested in the Robert Kennedy assassination, the assassination of Martin Luther King, Abraham Lincoln, and so on. And after a while, I started feeling that it was like there was a very clear pattern between the different assassinations, not always the way they were carried out in on the street level, but the way that the follow-up conspiracy, because there's always like two conspiracies, one that takes out the person in question, and then there's a follow-up conspiracy of silence, this cover-up that follows these big so-called events. And I started writing a book just for my own sake, trying to keep all of these names apart and see the how this whole thing was built up. And it got very confusing there for a while, because some of the people that I read about, like in one book, one guy was working for the CIA. In another book, the absolute same guy was working for the mob. And in a third one, he was working for the Secret Service. And in a fourth one, he was being funded by the FBI. And I thought, there's something very wrong here. But in the end, I found out that all of them were true. The same person were working for the CIA, but in bed with a mob, and being funded by the FBI and involved with the Secret Service. And that was not only one, but quite a few. And so the more I got into it, the more I started understanding how these organizations are so intertwined at the moment. I mean, the way I see it, there's not a lot of difference between the mob and the CIA and so on, and the FBI as well. They're all different faces of the same ball, or whatever you want to call it, the different faces of the same coin. And then in 1986, the Swedish Prime Minister was shot dead in the streets of Stockholm. His name was Olof Palme, and that was an absolute shock. It was such a national trauma in Sweden, because up to that date, Sweden was a very, very peaceful country, as far as I knew. No corruption. The police were the good guys. There was hardly any bad guys at all, so I thought that I grew up in a country that was a perfect illusion of a democracy. But then, after a little while, I started seeing that, my God, this exact same thing as after the JFK assassination, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King, and so on. What happened after those assassinations? Exactly the same thing was happening in Sweden. And that really got me intrigued, because with the other ones, I had made almost like a bullet list of how they were carried out. It's almost like they've been using a template that goes, I think, all the way back to Roman times, when they found sort of like a perfect template of how to get rid of somebody in a top power position, and how to trick the population of that country into thinking that it was the work of a lone crazy guy, a mad person who just did it because he was mad, and that there was no conspiracy behind it, so that this thing could just be disregarded right away as a violent crime and case closed. Boom. As soon as you got rid of the guy who did it, the crazy guy or the patsy, then you could just move on, and the population wouldn't even notice, and you could push forward, or they could push forward their agenda. And so when I looked at these bullet point lists from the other assassinations, I thought, if what I start to suspect is true, then in Sweden they would follow the same steps. And then I was actually able to predict what they were going to do in Sweden. And one day when my predictions became real, that when I saw that they were actually following the same, that really freaked me out, because I thought, my God, I was the country I grew up in is a different country than I thought, you know, because if this is carried out in Sweden, as in the States, as in other assassinations I was looking into in South America, South Africa, Germany, and so on, then there might be a very good possibilities that they are all connected. I mean, how would they otherwise be carried out in the same way? So that took me on a almost 30-year long journey of or quest, almost a quest for truth, trying to find out what happened, what happened, and who carried it out, and for what. And so after seeing that how they were carried out so similarly, I started looking at the different cases from a higher point, start trying to see how they were connected and by what force that would be powerful enough to get away with this. And so I've spent many, many years looking into and trying to figure out the different methods that they're using and how this template is fine-tuned. And if you want to, or in this show, I'll be very happy to show you how these templates are used and how they trick the population into believing that's the work of a lone crazy guy. The
Okay.
reason.
Yes, this is go ahead. Go ahead, Ollie.
No, the reason why it's always a lone crazy guy is because if he's alone, then by definition, there cannot be a conspiracy behind it, because a conspiracy is when two or more people plan a crime. So if he's alone, there's no conspiracy, there's no need to look into the crime for a motive. And if he's mad, then he just did it. He just went up and killed or blew up or whatever, shot this person for no apparent reason. He was crazy, and that was it. So if you can just get rid of the patsy quickly enough, then you can close the case and find out why it was carried out. But if you want to, I can go into a bit of detail how, like a template of how they carry out these assassinations, and then you will start seeing that you can see that on a global scale, almost, at least in the Western world, how they do it so regularly on the same in the same way.
Yes, Ollie, and I will definitely want to discuss the template. I have a couple of just quick questions for you before we jump into that. I think that's going to be a very important part of this interview. Being that you were born and raised outside of the USA, a lot of the conspiracies that you looked into were those from the USA, assassinations that occurred in the USA. May I ask, in your opinion, to speak for the world, but outside of the USA, those who do not come from the US, are they equally, in your opinion, concerned about these assassinations that occurred in our country? Do you find that in your travels?
I do. I think for a long time, I must say that for us who lives outside the US, it felt very strongly that the population of the States have been sleeping. I mean, it's been very hard for us to understand from the outside how the American people have been able to be so duped into not seeing what's going on. So I'm very happy to see that there's this awakening going on at the moment on a scale that I've never seen before.
Now, and you also mentioned that this template that we're going to talk about is mostly occurring in the Western meaning the United States, I imagine, is what you meant. Why do you feel that way, that this template is – in other words, I'm going to jump the gun a little bit. Was the template designed by the USA, do you think?
No, I think it was designed by the Romans. I really think it's going back, back, back. And when I see, when I say the Western world, I don't mean the States. I mean the whole Europe, USA, but also going down in South America and so on, because the U.S. Secret military forces has been down there. And this is also what I'm going to go into further down the line about who have been carrying out these things for so many years, because I found that it's actually the same group of mechanics as well that are involved in all these major assassinations, that they've been used since the early 60s, and they are active almost to this day. So I'm going to go into, if you want to, very great details on who have been carrying out these things.
I think that's very important. And thank you for clarifying what you meant by Western world, and also the designers designed by the Romans. And basically what you're describing, it's the same architects over and over. So basically what you did is you found a pattern, did you not?
I did, a very clear pattern.
Okay. So let's get into that. Let's begin with the beginning. Where was your first aha moment, if we may, if that's the right place to start, Ole? Where was your first aha moment in that there was a definite template, a design, if you will?
I don't think there was an exact aha moment. This is built on thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of hours of studying these things that have just added one little piece of puzzle. Jigsaw puzzle at a time, and then I felt that it's almost like I've been making a jigsaw puzzle but with a picture side down. You know, I found these pieces and managed to fit them in, but I when I did it, I had no real idea of what the finished picture would be like. So it's first that when I got all the pieces in place and I turned the whole thing around, that's when I started to see that, oh my god, Whoa. How is this possible that they have all been connected? And then once I started seeing that they were connected, then I started tracking down the different people that took part of it.
What was your first investigation? I mean, where did you start? Did you start with President Kennedy? Where did you start with just looking into certain things?
I started with JFK because that was a case that really intrigued me, and that was the one that got me going. Also, because I was a child when he was killed, and I remember very well the impact it had on my parents, and also the missile crisis, how the whole world was afraid of this nuclear war that was approaching. And so I grew up with that impact of fear. Also, my family, like I say, I was born in Denmark, and they were part of the resistance movement against the German occupation. So I grew up with all these stories about how, even though you come from a very small country, you need to stand up. Even if you're only one person, you need to stand up for what is right or what is just, even though it can be very scary and look very dangerous. You still need to stand up for these things. And like my granddad was in jail for helping Jews escape, and my dad was in the resistance movement. My grandmother was transporting weapons in her baby cot and so on. So this was part of my genes growing up.
Understood. So what did you, you know, first discover when you were alarmed, when you looked into the JFK? You described a little bit about this at the very beginning of the show, but something caught you, and then where did it go from there? How did it unfold for you, and where you have seemingly, beyond a shadow of a doubt, what happened? Can we talk about JFK? Can we talk about what you think has happened there?
Anything you want to know?
I'd love to. I'd love to. How many shooters were there, and who do you think they were, and do you have names for the shooters?
I got names of more or less all of them, I would say. If you want to, I can go through them from the right to the left. If you want to, we can start in the Deltex building. I think
Well,
your listeners, they're aware of the layout of the Dealey Plaza, how it's what it looks like, and so on, the different.
I think some of them may be, and we're coming up on a break here, so don't mind if I have to interrupt you. In a couple of minutes, we're going to go to 1 minute. I'm sorry, the producer is saying so. Perhaps what we should do is, yes, I would love to look at that area, the daily, as you say, and it sounds like we're actually going into a break a little bit early here. So we're going to take this break, Ole, and when we come back, we're going to. And welcome back. Thanks for being here and tuning in this evening. Again, if you want to go to Ole's web.com, if you want to check into other things as we're going along. So, yes, briefly, Ole, let's talk about the Dealey Plaza. Let's briefly talk about the layout, as you will, and go ahead and explain the rest of it because it's fascinating.
Okay, what I want to say is that the group of assassins that I'm going to talk about more about is called Operation 40. This Operation 40 was started in the late 50s, early 1960s. It was created by it was Dwight E. Eisenhower, the president, who gave his vice president Richard Nixon the task of creating a hit team of top assassins, super secret hit team of top assassins. And like I say, it was Richard Nixon who was given the task to form that group. And this group was formed by it consisted of exiled Cuban military people, mercenaries, ex-police people that came from Cuba. But it was also, it had the people in charge were CIA people. And the CIA people in charge were Ted Shackley, the blonde ghost. There was E. Howard Hunt. You had David Attlee Phillips, who was super central in the JFK assassination. And these people got this group together. It was called Operation 40. One of the reasons was that they were 40 members to start with. And this was created to take out Fidel Castro. That was the whole idea. Because when Fidel Castro took over Cuba, it really made a mess for the mob and also for big financial interest in the States going all the way up in the government. And they were very, very angry with Fidel Castro. So they wanted to take out the bearded guy. But what happened was that when the missile crisis came, I don't know if your listeners know about it, but that was Khrushchev in Russia was sending a ship with missiles going towards Cuba, and the Kennedy and all the military staff and so on, they made an ultimatum that if this ship crosses this longitude, they would start a nuclear war on Russia, against Russia. And by mistake, this ship actually did cross the line, and the whole military industrial complex was just like screaming at Kennedy, press the button, because he was more or less sitting with a finger on the button that could have created this whole massive Holocaust. And people say that was there, they say that Kennedy was sitting almost with tears in his eyes, just saying, I refuse to be the one that commits this crime against humanity. And from that point, up until then, he had been an easy president for the global elite. I'm going to go more into the global elite because this is really the power elite that I truly and very strongly believe are behind more or less all of these conspiracies, if not all of them, up to this very day. And like Kennedy, up to that point, had been an easy person to manipulate and get around with. But then after this thing, suddenly he started a totally new direction. He said he it was like an almost like a spiritual awakening, I think, when he had that thing with a finger on the button. And from that on, he suddenly started a totally new, in a new direction. He said, I'm going to crush the CIA into 1,000 pieces, making the CIA deadly enemy. He got his brother chasing the mob who had helped JFK to get into the White House through his father. He turned his back on them and got Robert Kennedy to chase them, which he did very efficiently. He said, I'm going to withdraw out of the out of Vietnam, which was at that time, the war hadn't even started. There was only like, yeah, I think 16,000 military advisors there. And this, I mean, people in the military industrial complex were so, so angry with this, because the whole thing with this war and the agenda of this whole global elite is that they want war, death and destruction. That's the name of the game, because that is where they get the power, they get their billions, they get all of that. They thrive on these horrible things that normal people are the victims of. He also wanted to withdraw from the Federal Reserve, taking back the power, the financial power, and getting out of this, the grip of the Federal Reserve, which is a super criminal institution, and it's absolutely not federal. It's a private cartel of banks, and the one that totally control the economic situation in the States and in other countries as well. This is also what Abraham Lincoln did, exactly the same, wanting to get out of the grip of this financial grip. And this is what, when people do that, they get stopped very violently. And so what happened was that the people behind the assassination wanted JFK stopped very quickly. And what they did was that they joined forces so that the Chicago mob, the mob in Louisiana, the mob in Florida, and so on, they joined up with the CIA. The people in the Secret Service was involved. The money came from the military industrial complex and the oil tycoons in Texas and other places. And so the hit team was put together of members from Operation 40, but also members from the Chicago mob and other people. So I was just gonna, if I can go a quick tour of Dealey Plaza and just name the different shooters and where they were and so on. Also, one thing that I forgot to say was that the man that was put in charge of funding Operation 40 was a young man by the name of George Herbert Walker Bush. At that time, a low-rank CIA person who was about to build his way up through the ranks. And so now we're talking, that's George Bush Sr., the first Bush president, and earlier this director of the CIA and so on. So in Dealey Plaza, the day when the shots were fired, in the Daltex building on the second floor, where just under the fire stairs, there was one shooter. His name was Chucky Nicoletti. He was a hitman from the Chicago mob. And the spotter, because all of these shooters had, there was one shooter, one spotter at least. And the spotter in this Daltex building, his name was Nestor Izquierdo. He was a black exile Cuban mercenary who was connected to the Operation 40 thing, the team. Mm-hmm. And in that building as well were Johnny Rosselli, that was the link between the Chicago mob and the CIA. And also in that very same building was George Herbert Walker Bush. That is more or less proved 100% proven as a fact today. So if we go to the school book depository, the sixth floor where Lee Harvey Oswald is said to have been, The real shooter in that window, not all of these people did any shooting, but they were there with rifles, but not all were shooting. The guy, as far as I know, the guy in the window in the sniper's nest, his name was Eladio Del Valle. He was also connected to Operation 40. And the spotter was Arminios Diaz Garcia, a black exiled Cuban as well, who was part of Operation 40. Then on the left-hand side of the same floor was a man by the name of Richard Kane. He was one of the hitmen from the Chicago mob as well. Then if we go down on in the street level position and you move across towards the grassy knoll, there was a car parked and there was one shooter there. This guy, I'm not really sure who it was. It could have been Frank Sturgis, who was connected to Operation 40, or Roscoe White, which was, he was a Dallas police officer. There's also another option. But these people have both claimed that they were part of this thing. So I'm not sure which one was there. Then if you move further to the left, there's the so-called badge man. And this badge man was a French guy called Lucien Sarti. He was a hitman from the Marseille mob and was flown in just for this operation. He was a highly skilled assassin and was used in many different killings like this. Then if we continue towards the picket fence and the grassy knoll, the man behind, next to the tree, was a man who's still alive. His name is James Files, and he's the guy who claims, and I truly believe him, was the one that shot the final headshot, Kennedy, the thing that blew his head, half of his head off. Then also behind the picket fence, there was a secret service or a fake secret service man. His name was Bernard Baker, and he was part of Operation 40. He was also one of the Watergate burglars. And around the whole thing, there were additional shooters. There was one guy further towards the what do you call it, the viaduct, the bridge across the street. His name was Harry Weatherford, Weatherspoon. And so these are the basic guys who did the shooting. But you also had the guy with the umbrella man. And many people had thought that he had that the umbrella was like a dart gun or a secret weapon or something like that. But I think that the reason why he was there and the reason why he had the umbrella up on a sunny day was to show the exact point where everybody should start shooting, because they needed that all shots were fired at the same time, more or less, so that they could blame it on one patsy, in this case, Lee Harvey Oswald. And in front of him was another guy who was standing waving, an exiled Cuban. The umbrella man, his name was Roy Hargraves, and he was also very closely connected to Operation 40. The guy in front of him, his name was Felipe Vidal Santiago, also very closely connected to Operation 40. And this guy has been working over the years under the alias. They have many different alias, but one of his main alias had been Charles Morgan. This Charles Morgan was in Sweden in 1985 trying to hire assassins to be part of the hit on the Swedish Prime Minister Olof Palme. So you see, there's one of the connections, direct personal connection between Dealey Plaza and the assassination in Stockholm 23 years later. But also, E. Howard Hunt, who was also in Dealey Plaza, and was taking part of the whole thing in the background, he was one of involved in the Watergate burglary as well. And when you look at the different presidents that have been involved in this, because in my opinion, I think JFK was the last real elected president. All the rest of the people in this long, long row have been part of the power elite that took over. Because I strongly believe that what happened that day in Dealey Plaza, as well as what happened in Sweden, was a takeover, a brutal takeover, but where it was blamed on a lone crazy guy, and nobody really understood what actually happened, that it was a a power that a brutal power that took over your country and have been in power ever since. All the precedents that have followed can be linked to this thing. So if you take, for instance, Lyndon Johnson, he was the vice president of JFK. They hated each other. They really, really hated each other. But he was so close to being put away in jail. The very same day as JFK was shot, there were people coming with evidence accusing Lyndon Johnson of at least 8 murders that he had committed through his personal henchman, a man by the name of Mark Wallace, who was also, it was his fingerprint that was the only thing that was found in the so-called sniper's nest in the school book depository. But he had Lyndon B. Johnson had at least 8 people killed. One of them was his own sister, and the man who killed him was this Mark Wallace. And this and many other crimes was it was getting very, very close. So Johnson knew that if he did not take out JFK, he would go to jail. His whole life would be destroyed, and so on. So it was almost a matter of hours.
May I ask just a couple of questions before we continue? Thank you. Wonderful. First of all, while we're on Lyndon Johnson, did JFK know about the murders that Lyndon had Johnson had committed?
I'm not sure he knew about the details. There were people put leading an investigation on getting him to a trial and put away.
Okay. And the other question that I have is, you've described quite an array of those who, most of the people that you mentioned, well, they were all men for one, and apparently all associated with Operation 40. And you are correct. E. Howard Hunt, yes, was also a part of, he was indicted for the Watergate. His what he had infiltrated and what he had done in Watergate, and then you're saying that E. Howard Hunt was also part of Operation 40. But what I would like to know, what you've just described, and thank you, the visual of it, I think everyone can appreciate it. You described everything quite well. We can just picture all of these individuals. How do you know that these individuals that you have just named were in those positions that day? In the Daily Plaza, are there photos of these individuals?
Not photos.
Okay. How do we know that they were present that day? How do we know?
This is, like I said, it's these conclusions are after thousands and thousands and thousands of hours, and people who have come forward, people who have leaked, whistleblowers, all of these things. Also, people who have been bragging. You know, because very often these assassins, some of them are heavy drinkers and they start bragging when they're drunk, and other people are very, very disciplined and hard, you know, quiet type of mercenary type. But it's been, like I say, it's been thousands of hours and so okay. many books. So it's just pieces of puzzles that I fit it together, and I've had a major article in Veterans Today where yes. I presented this with all the photos of all these members and all of these things, and it has been approved by many international experts that have confirmed these things. There's some small question marks around some of it, but the big picture is there.
Okay, thank you. And then you mentioned that it was at this time, this juncture, when JFK was assassinated, that our country, the United States of America, was taken over by a brutal power. Is that correct?
That is totally correct. And this is
and has
why
that,
I think...
has that power been in place ever since? I believe you said that as well.
Yeah, that is my strong opinion.
Who is
yes.
it?
This is why I think it's so important to look into these assassination, not because somebody was shot in 1963. If it had been the work of a lone crazy guy, I mean, okay, he was a nice guy, he was shot, I'm very sorry, case closed. But the reason why I've been so focused on trying to expose these things is because the people, the power behind them, are still sitting there, and they are the ones causing this mayhem that is going on. So that is why I really do everything I can to expose the whole long row of these things in great detail, so that it can become obvious for people that are waking up to see what's going on, so that it will stop. Because the only reason it is able to continue is because we've been so asleep for such a long time.
Yes. You know, I wanted to ask you, since you've done such a tremendous amount of reading, are you aware of ex-Governor Jesse Ventura's book that was recently released that is called They Killed Our President?
I've heard of it. I haven't read it. No.
I'm curious about that. And why I mentioned it to you, Ole, is that he indeed is yet another patriot, if you will, of this country, who also believes that if you can prove what really happened to JFK, the rest will open, you know, all the cans of worms will open, and it will all be seen for what it is. So he's also in alignment with your thoughts, and vice versa, on we have to go back to the JFK assassination. We have to show the public what happened. So I just wanted to throw that in there.
No, I totally agree. That was the starting shot. That was where the whole thing started. You know, Eisenhower, when he left over his seat, his presidential seat, he warned us about the military-industrial complex in his last speech. That's the speech that is just in the beginning of the JFK movie, where he said it's just everywhere. It has just infiltrated every single little town, everything. And this power is still there. They took over with a very brutal coup d'etat. And like I say, they've been in motion ever since. That's why.
Is Operation 40 still a group of assassins? Is it still in existence today?
I think they changed the names 100 times, you know, but some of these guys, I mean, now they're in their late 70s and early 80s, but some of them are still around and very, very doing a lot. You know, if they're not actually killing people at the moment, they are training other assassins and so on.
Okay.
And
it's evolved into another group, but basically the premise of Operation 40 is still around, would you say?
Yeah, because it's like I heard an interview with one of them, and they got the question. He got the question, why did you use the same team? And he said, why change it?
Right.
Why would you change a winning team? It worked fine. Why change it? And this is what is super for someone like me, when you start seeing that the same people pops up again and again and again and again. And that's why if I can go into some more of these people who were in Operation 40 and just take
yes,
you
please.
Down the
yes,
memory
please.
Lane type of thing.
Sure.
Okay, there was one man called David Morales. He was called El Indio. He was one of the commanding officers in Operation 40. Very, very brutal man. And he was present in Dealey Plaza. I mean, that day in Dealey Plaza, there were so many of these top assassins, not all of them involved in it, but so many at that place. It was almost like, you know, if a big rock concert is taking place somewhere, then all the musicians in that town or that area comes to this place, because this was very well known in these among these type of people. So in Dealey Plaza, when you study the photos, they just pop up all over the place. Anyway, I lost the thread now.
That's okay. You were talking about David Morales, who is one of the commanding officers of the Operation 40.
Exactly. Yeah. And this guy was also the guy, he was at the Ambassador Hotel when Robert Kennedy was shot. 1968, that's some years later. He was also the guy that was the one that killed Che Guevara. Che Guevara was one of Fidel Castro's closest associates. And Felix Rodriguez, who was another top member of Operation 40, this Felix Rodriguez was given the task to track down Che Guevara in Bolivia. He went down there with and got some military, local military guys, and David Morales. These tracked him down, and Felix Rodriguez ordered him dead. So David Morales was the one that killed him. And as far as I know, Felix Rodriguez to this very day is carrying Che Guevara's wristwatch, his arm watch. And Felix Rodriguez is also one of the key members and closest associates to Oliver North in the whole Iran-Contras affair, with the weapon smuggling going from the States to Nicaragua, and then weapons, no, drugs going the opposite direction. One of the people also involved deeply involved in the Iran-Contras one was one of the pilots. His name was Barry Seals. And Barry Seals was one of the pilots for Operation 40. He was also, like I said, one of the major players in the Iran-Contras scandal. And one of the things they did there, like I said, they stole weapons from the National Guard under, as far as I know, the supervision of Colin Powell. Then these weapons were, they got rid of the serial numbers, and they were flown out to the Contras, which was a created army to fight the Sandinista government. And so weapons were being flown down to them. It was with American support. And then when the planes, these medevac, big military medevac planes, returned, they were filled up with drugs, heavy, heavy drugs. And one of the places they went to, one of the major airports, was a, or it was, it wasn't a big, it was just a little a landing strip, but it was in a town called Mena in Arkansas. This is from where the whole crack epidemic in the state started, was from this little airport in Mena. And at that time, the governor of Arkansas was a man by the name of Bill Clinton. He was one of the guys who received all of these drugs together with his partner Dan Lasseter. And at times, even George W. Herbert Walker Bush was there as well, receiving these drugs. These persons, like one of the pilots, Barry Seals, and other pilots, secretly took photos of these people, as their own life's insurance. This Barry Seals, he was just about to give a testimony against George Bush Senior when he was shot dead in Baton Rouge. And this was just 1 week before the Swedish Prime Minister was taken out, because he was also involved in these international illegal arms deals. Then you have, do you know when John Lennon was shot?
Well, you know what? I was just going to ask you about that. As you're moving closer to that, it seems obvious to me. Yes. The answer
Okay.
is yes.
The reason that many of these people have been killed, like Martin Luther King, John F. Kennedy, Mahatma Gandhi, Lady Diana, John Lennon, also Bob Marley, he was also murdered, even though people think he died from cancer. But the reason why they have been taken out is because they've been standing up for peace. And this is the mass most biggest problem for this war machine, that when somebody that people really listen to stands up and say, let's make friends and wars and babies, not wars, let's stop, get out of the army, all of these things.
And welcome back for those of you who are just tuning in. My guest this evening is Ole Dammegard. Of course, the website is lightonconspiracies.com. And if you forget about that, just go ahead and go to thetruthandi.com, and he'll remain linked up there. I also want to thank everybody for allowing Revolution Radio to continue our journey as we are growing and expanding. It is through your help, the listeners, because we are only listener supported, and we couldn't do it without you. If you would like to contribute and keep us on the air, go ahead and go to freedomslips.com. And, you can also join the chat room, if you will, if you have questions. And I will be addressing the questions that are coming through the chat room. So I want to thank Thomas, our producer, a.k.a. a mad painter, and we all call him Painter for short. He always gives me the questions that are going on in the chat room. So we will address those questions as well. I will not forget you, I promise. John Lennon was assassinated December 8th, 1998, apparently, or anyway, newsworthy. All the news reported that he was murdered by a man named Mark David Chapman, I should say. John Lennon and Yoko Ono had just released a few weeks earlier an album called Double Fantasy. And most of us know that John Lennon was planning on using that album to come back into the music scene. And there are also some other rumors that John was going to start a world tour, a peace tour. And it was going to be very similar to what the Grateful Dead used to do, which was travel from city to city, and those who buy tickets to the shows just sort of get on a bus and follow the band. And John was very interested in also doing that, so that he would basically be collecting people from all over the world to follow him in a movement for peace with the launching of Double Fantasy. Mark David Chapman was sentenced to 20 years for taking John Lennon's life. I don't really know. I haven't seen anything new about Chapman. He was asked in an interview a few years ago by Barbara Walters why he did it. And his answer, in a very straight face, he looked at Barbara Walters and he said, "I thought by killing him, I would acquire his fame." And that is the lie that has been sold to all of us worldwide who, may he rest, assassinated. And they put a story together that doesn't make sense to a two-year-old, more or less an adult, and we bought it. Can you talk more about that, Ole?
Yeah, just like you say, he was very close to becoming a major problem again for this war machine. And it's like with these assassinations, many of these and these big conspiracies, many of them are like a no-brainer once you look into it. It's very obvious. I mean, an eight-year-old would be able to sort out that if, for instance, with Sirhan Sirhan, who was accused of killing Robert Kennedy, if his gun contains a lot less bullets than that were fired, it's very obvious that there must have been at least a second shooter. But instead of understanding the truth, we're being so pumped with the official story that in the end, people just give up looking for the real truth. But just like with Sirhan Sirhan, Mark Chapman was one of these people that they've used as patsies very often. With this template I was talking about, they use people that are very sensitive to hypnotism, who are weak mentally or have a violent background or say violent things and stuff like that. But the patsies in these cases are what I truly believe have been mind controlled, that they have, they get activated by a certain keyword. First, they're being treated for months and months under horrific circumstances to split their personality up in at least two parts so that they can compartmentalize, that one part of the brain has absolutely no idea what the other personality is up to. And you can see this very often, that after an assassination like this is done, the guy who is taken for it, after accused for the assassination,
yes,
will just be standing waiting like a zombie. And
yes,
then once they start telling their story, it's like a loop. It's like a tape recording going around, round, round. No emotions, no nothing. They can't even remember it. They can't remember anything around it. Just the exact story I shot him because of this. I shot him because of this. I shot him because of this. You know,
Right.
it's, yeah. And like, but I always go to a crime scene like with Farmer Brown logic. You know,
Yes.
if the explosion was in one place, then everything would be blown up from where the bomb was supposed to be. You know, but many times when you go into these big conspiracies, the official story does not make sense at all, at all. And this is just the case as well with Mark Chapman. Like he was standing to the right of Yoko Ono and John Lennon when they came this evening and parked the limo parked outside the Dakota building. And Yoko left the car first and started walking towards the building. And then John came out. Mark Chapman was just standing there on the right-hand side. Then John Lennon passed him and started walking towards the building, and several shots were fired. John went down, deadly wounded, started crawling into the building, and Yoko Ono came out, screamed, and then he was taken to hospital where he later died. But when you look at the crime scene, all shots that hit John came straight from the left, and Mark Chapman was standing behind him, quite a few steps to the right. Once again, doesn't make any sense. So the big question is, who was standing to the left of John when these shots were fired? I think this is a question that is well worth asking. And this very evening, on that specific date, there was a doorman that works extra that evening only. And his name was Jose Perdomo. He was a nice-looking gentleman in his late 60s or something like that. Glasses, a little bald, looked very nice and sophisticated. This Jose Perdomo was for 10 years one of the highest-ranking officers of Operation 40. Now you tell me how big are the odds that one of the best, the most skilled assassins in the United States are there that very evening in the exact position where the shots were fired from, and Mark Chapman is the guilty one. Doesn't make sense.
No, it absolutely doesn't. And obviously, you know, and I'm going to ask the listeners as well, are you not getting angry? I hope you are, because when I listen to this, not only do I get angry, I get, you know, because it brings it all back up again, Ole, but it also makes me realize how insidious this is and how very sad, because some of the people that you're mentioning, and good on you for the work that you've done with this. But, you know, the Bob Marleys, the Martin Luther Kings, the John Lennons, the JFK, RFK, the list goes on and on. Princess Diana, loving individuals who were really making a mark on this planet and really changing the hearts of men and women and children. It's hard to believe sometimes that somebody, for instance, like John Lennon, they picked off, assassined all of these individuals for one reason only at the end of the day, because those who are in charge, this brutal power that is in charge, Ole, is afraid of people like John Lennon.
Yeah, super true. I think it's very important to understand that the people in charge today, or at least the ones that are ruling at the moment, they are super, super, super criminal. When you look into who is actually up in the power pyramid, which we can go into in more detail, these
Yes.
people, they look very nice and you know, they have nice suits and they look very sophisticated and drive nice cars and look good on TV. You see them on TV on a daily basis, but they are super, super corrupt and criminal. I mean, we're talking literally they're getting away with mass murder. And it's just time for it to stop. It's time to wake up and stop this madness because the mentality behind this group is absolute mad. It's absolute mad when you look upon it on a point from the people, you know, where all we want is peace and harmony and love and friendship and to make this world into this beautiful place it's supposed to be instead of this horrific, cold, scary place that we are being told that we live in. Because I tell you, the for so many years, it's almost, if it's not 30 years, it's very close to 30 years that I've been spending so many of my awake hours trying to find out what actually happened. And when it doesn't matter if it's a civil war somewhere in Africa, or if it's a massive as a conspiracy bomb or mass shooting or assassination, I track it back, I track it back, I track it back, and I come to the same small group of people that are behind it again and again and again. If they're not funding it, they've been training the people, they've been supplying them with bombs. It's the same people behind this, which gives me great hope, because I just think, you know, it really is like a bully in a schoolyard that has been terrorizing the neighborhood. And they've been getting away with it for generations. And it's just time for us to stop it. Because, like, this group is only like a couple of thousand, and we are billions. So it's such a massive joke that we're letting it happen. And the only reason why it will continue, or it is continuing, is because we are asleep and allowing it. And we're even helping it. We're even helping them. And in many of these interviews, I speak directly to people in uniform, police officers, SWAT teams. I speak to military personnel as well. And I speak directly to members of this global elite with a message of, you know, like, wake up. I'll be very happy to do that in this show as well, because it's only because these people in uniform are being totally duped into believing that they're doing something good, instead of understanding really whose agenda they're defending, and against the people. They have sworn an oath to defend normal people, you know, to work for what is right and what is legal and just. And instead, they are the ones defending and supporting this brutal, murderous agenda that is going on. It's really tragic. It's so, so sad when you look into it.
Correct, correct. You know, I was going to ask you if you knew anything about the deaths of Dodi Fayed and Princess Diana. I always found it very suspicious. You know, at the time, I mean, this is interesting. I was working with, who is now Sir, but Elton John, and Elton John was very good friends with Princess Diana. And so you should hear what I heard from that end. I'm not going to get into that right now, but it was very suspicious right from the start from our group of people that were in touch, knew Diana and Dodi Fayed. And yet, I mean, maybe I can ask you, you know, the rumors were that the Queen did it because Princess Diana had, you know, been very different, and she'd broken all the rules, so to speak. And, you know, even though she was just kind and loving and everything, but she'd broken all the rules of whatever the Queen had in mind.
Was that a question?
Daughter and fiance.
I'm sorry, the sound broke up. But if you're asking me if it was an assassination, the answer is yes, 100% okay. Yes.
Okay.
She was, and the reason why she was taken out, in my opinion, was she as well was one of these people that normal people listened to. You know, it's not, they didn't just, they adored her. And what she had been standing up for the last year or two of her life was actively work against landmines. And landmines are super crucial for this military-industrial complex and the global elite. Because with landmines, what they do is they depopulate big areas of a country. You know, they send out troops to they say that they're looking for the Bin Laden or Saddam Hussein or some other bearded guy that doesn't exist, some kind of phantom. These people are sent out there, and then when they get to the area that they want, I mean, it's normally minerals, oils, drugs. These are the things that they are after, even though it's called Operation Freedom or Operation Stardust or whatever. It's these things that is what the army moves in for, even though the army is not aware of it. But then get rid of the local population with these landmines. They fill the whole place with landmines, so that they blow up some people. They put out toys that are armed with landmines as well, so they blow up some children. And with these awful happenings, they make the local population move away, and they can stay away for like 20, 30 years, because these landmines nowadays, and I'm very ashamed to say that Sweden is one of the main manufacturers of them, they're not even made of metal anymore, so you can't really find them because they're in different plastic materials and so on. But with that, they get the population out of the way, and then that area of the country can be used for army bases or airstrips, either if they need that for refueling planes to go to other places, or what it's mostly done for is that they have their drugs in that country that needs to be flown out in different ways. So the landmines are very important. And then when she stood up and spoke against it, and I mean millions and millions and millions of people were listening to her, she became a major threat. Also, that she knew a lot of the secrets about the English royal family, and the English royal family are deeply involved in all of these things as well. So I think these are the combination of different things. I do not think at all it had anything with an Arab baby or anything like that to do. That is just the official story. But I can tell you that when you follow this template, one of the things that always happens is that the surveillance cameras stop working. I mean, if you and I do something, they will catch us. But when these things happen, they by default are always taken out. They never work. And if you want to, I can go into details how it was carried out and what happened.
Yes, please. And before we go into the carried out part, just a couple of quick questions from the audience, and we can just nail these very quickly. Karen asked, does the list of those who were assassinated, in your opinion, include Malcolm X?
Yeah, for sure. For
okay.
sure.
Thank you. Because she said that, you know, because he was an advocate for peace as well.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Did he fit in the list? And another CJ asks, Roxy, can you please ask if there is a strong group attempting to negate the hold those behind the dark industrial military complex have on humanity? I'm not sure if I understand the question.
I didn't understand that either. What does that mean?
Negate. I don't even know if that's the right word that they're using. I'm assuming it is. I think what CJ is asking is there a group who's inside of the military complex that's basically against all of humanity? I imagine that's what the question is.
The answer is yes again.
Okay. And Joe Quim asks, Roxy, how would government mafia benefit from killing John Lennon?
I think we already answered
that. Covered that. It's
the same. It's the
synonymous
same reason.
With peace. Yes.
It's as soon as you stand up for peace, you become a threat.
Great. I'll see you all in my next lifetime then.
No, but I tell you, that's why also we're being painted out
monitored
as terrorists now. I mean, now truth seekers are being targeted. And what do truth seekers stand for? They stand for peace. I mean, I believe that, I don't know you personally, but I'm sure that one of the reasons you put yourself on the line here is because you want peace and harmony and love and all of these things for the rest of humanity, not total a fascist state where the army is against the people, where a brutal police state. This is the reason, that's what we are standing up for, to avoid, and that's why they target us.
Yes, in many different ways, and I agree. So now let's talk about, you said you were going to explain how this was all carried out, so I'm sure that we're very interested in hearing this. And can you briefly tell us what coup d'etat in slow motion? Can you tell us what that is? Is this a book?
It's a book that I've written over all of these years, and it's about mainly about the assassination of the Swedish Prime Minister Olof Palme, but it's also with all the links, international links, and going into the details and how they're connected with JFK, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King, and so on, as well as the sinking of MS Estonia. That I don't know if you heard about that. It was a ferry that was blown up and killing almost 1,000 people. But it's still to this day being blamed that it was an accident, but it was not.
Interesting. So this is all our whole conversation then for this evening is in this book,
And also
right?
this ferry disaster is directly connected as well to 9/11. This is the whole thing. All of these things are connected. It's the same people behind them. This is the mind-blowing thing. So, but at the same time, it's amazing for someone like me because it makes it more understandable how they can repeat it and how they can get away with it all the time because it's the same people. But if you want to, I would like to just since you have a lot of mass shootings and so on going on in your country at the moment, I would very much like to just describe the template of how and why these things are carried out. Would that be okay?
Yes, please. Please, yes.
Okay, one of the things they do, they have different methods. One is distraction, and another one that's like get the people to look the other way. So if you got internal problems or there's a lot of things going on that you need to hide, like the Iran-Contras or anything like that, you get a scandal like the Monica Lewinsky or something like something that diverts the attention away from what's going on, and they manage to keep the media totally brain dead, looking the other way for months with things like Monica Lewinsky and other crimes like that. And when these things happen, it's very important to check out what's going on in the other direction, you know. So, but another one, a classical one they're using all the time, is an old Roman method as well. It's like a three-step rocket called problem, reaction, solution. Problem, reaction, solution. Create a problem to get a reaction so that you can come with a solution. So sometimes I give an example. For instance, if I'm in, let's say, whatever country, I'm in Austria or something like that, and I want the police to have totally military power to be able to kick in doors, to arrest people without a warrant, to keep them detained for however long, to just do whatever they want and have streets, tanks in the streets and people walking around with bazookas, whatever. If I'm, let me say now that I'm the one in power in Austria, for instance. If I just did that, like they used to do military coups in South America and so on. If you look at history, when the military took over, supported by the United States again, when the military took over, they did a violent coup d'etat where they went into the government building, they shot everybody, they blew them up, and so on. So in a very short time, very often overnight, they came to a top position of power, which was super for them. But what followed was a very, very messy situation because suddenly they had problems with the population. The people were very, very angry with them. So they were like uprisings, there were demonstrations, there were guerrilla movements going on, there were all of these things. So the military had to do mass arrests. They had to fill big football stadiums with thousands and thousands of people. They filled the jails. They started mass executing people. Every person they killed, these people had friends and families. So then you had problems with the friends and families, and it just got messier and messier and messier. And other countries also made sanctions against these countries. So that is not.
My guess is Ole Dammegard. You were just about to express a little bit more about, you just talked about the problem reaction solution method, and you wanted to discuss a little bit more about, in the modern day, I imagine, in regards to, you know, our lights are on, but nobody's home here in America. But I have to say something, I have to interject something, and maybe you've got something to comment about this as well, Ole. I think 9/11, things like 9/11, very most recently Sandy Hook, the Boston Marathon, I think people are starting to wake up.
I totally agree. It's wonderful. It's absolutely wonderful. But it's also because they're getting extremely sloppy and very stressed for time, I think. This is why they need, or they think that they need to speed these things up. And you see it almost like on a daily basis, these new mass shootings. And this is a problem reaction solution thing that as soon as you hear me go into details, you will see that it fits in on all of these ones. So can I go on?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, okay. The floor is yours.
So when I said the old way to do it is really messy when you do it with violence. So instead, what a better way to do it, or the way that it's carried out these days are, what you do is, and I, like I said, today, there are different trends when it comes to these events. At the moment, it's mass shootings and explosions, blowing up things. So, for instance, if we take a mass shooting, or let's take a bomb instead, what I need to do, my agenda was to get a lot of military armed police in the streets of Austria, or whatever country you want to say, the States, but you already have it because it's been going on for quite a while in your country. But what I do is I secretly create a problem, in this case, a mass shooting or a bomb. I place this bomb it needs to be in a public place. It needs to be somewhere where I can get a real reaction. And it needs to be an emotional reaction, not getting the logic reaction from people. So I place this bomb, and the key factor where I place it, it needs to be in a public place, and it needs to hit women and children. These are the key factors, because that is where you get the emotional reaction. It doesn't work with an old people home or an old factory or anything like that. No, it's like a daycare center or in a subway where there's lots of children and women and so on. So that's where I place it. At the same time, I start preparing a patsy. And this patsy is someone that works in media. Either can be somebody, a lone crazy guy, or it can be a group. Sometimes it can be let's say the Mormons or the yogis or something like that. Then I leak out in media in the weeks coming up to this event. I start leaking out in media that this group, let's say the yogis, these yogis, they have meetings every Tuesday evening and they're listening to a bearded guy. And if he says something, they will listen. And if he says come on Sunday, they will come on Sunday. And maybe they have they're planning something, and maybe they have weapons underneath the yoga hall or something. You leak that out to prepare the subconscious of people to saying, that is a bit of a weird group over there.
Right.
So you prepare like that. And this group can be anyone. Normally this group is someone they have problems with anyway. Free thinkers, or in these days, it would be, if it's not already there, it would be conspiracies, fact seekers or truth seekers or peacekeeping people. These are the people that are being targeted now. The trends in these things also, when it comes to the patsies, it used to be East Germans or Russians and so on during the Cold War. Then the trend went into Muslims. And the Muslims have been perfect because they speak in a strange language. They look quite threatening, you know, with big eyebrows and black hair. And they've got strange names, and they come from a country that most people have no idea where it comes from. So we've been so brainwashed with this Muslim equals terrorist, Islam equals terrorism. It's absolutely not true. It's just what we've been pumped with. So anyway, we prepare this patsy and make them look weird in media. We also prepare evidence so that as soon as the bomb blows up, the evidence will point that way. The patsy.
Right.
Okay. So at the same time also, I have my own investigation on standby. This is crucial, that the people in the investigation are people that I control. And this is very often through Freemasonry network or these things that you got. So the key people in this investigation just moves forward and they kick out all normal, honest investigators and detectives and so on, so that I am in control of the investigation. Okay, so I got the patsy prepared, I got the evidence, I got my own investigation on standby. And what I also do on a stand when I follow this template is I have a drill at the same time. And this drill is at exactly, it's aiming at exactly the same target, but it's a drill. And one of the reasons why I have this drill is, for one thing, is it's a total, it makes the situation very confused when you look into it, because it's a drill that halfway through goes live, and most people involved had absolutely no idea what they're involved in until they see the explosives going on or so on. But it's one very effective way of getting the explosives in the correct place without anyone really suspecting anything, and also get the patsy there. So you need to get some yogis there. So you will tell them then, oh, please come here, join this film set or whatever, and you just need to bring this back over there. So these yogis have absolutely no idea that they're actually being prepared as patsies. Okay, so this the drill is also on standby, and so it's crucial as well when this bomb explodes. It doesn't work in the middle of the night or late in the evening or so on, because what I want the emotional reaction, because then people don't think, they just go for the emotions. So what I do is I let this bomb go off early morning when people have just woken up, they're on their way to work or so on. It's very important also that they're on their way, not that they're indoors or something like, but so that they will feel that when this bomb goes off in this public place, that they have been threatened as well. So what I do is I wait maybe in 9:15, 8:30, something like that in the morning, and boom, off goes the bomb. The media, who's almost on standby, will start pumping out these horrific images of blown up children and women and all of these things, which is pumped out. And all of this is done to get the reaction from normal people saying, oh my God, this is awful, awful, awful. At the same time when this is going on, I start in media pointing towards the yogis. It's the yogis, it's the yogis, it's the yogis. And so people would turn to me, who they've elected to be in power of this country, and say, my God, something needs to be done. You have to take care of these violent, brutal, peace-loving yogis. You have to do something.
Right.
So I, who are in power, say, well, the only way I can do this is by having tanks in the streets, the police with bazookas being able to do whatever they want, kick in doors, detain people, whatever. And the people will say, yes, do it, do it. So I move in with my tanks. I kick out this yogic group that I hated anyway and become a hero because I solved the problem. And at the same time, my agenda has moved forward. And what I do is I leave the tanks and all of these soldiers and police officers. Suddenly the police have bulletproof vests and so on, because the yogis have been so threatening. And what I do is I leave them in the street. Sometimes nowadays I also have martial law, which they've started after the Boston bombing, martial law, martial law, martial law, to get the population used to this. So I leave the troops and the police and all of these things. I leave them there. And then after 10 days or 2 weeks, I pull them back. But I don't pull everyone back. I let people get used to see the tanks and the police and all of these things for their protection, because all of this is for your protection. You know, it has nothing to do with control. It's for your protection. And then after 2 weeks or so, I pull it back, but I leave about 20%. And then I add to the surveillance things, all of these things, you know, after 9/11 that has been pushed upon the world from this inside job that 9/11 was. It had absolutely nothing to do with foreign terrorists or anything like that. It was a total insider job. So was Sandy Hook, so was Boston bombing. So it's from the inside. It is from the inside. And this is so crucial also to understand, that these precedents that have been following on a long line are involved with super, super criminal powers. So it doesn't matter if it's George Bush Senior or Junior or Obama, it's just a different face in front of this war machine. That's why nothing happens when you go to election. It's totally rigged. You have like it's the same body with different arms. Which one arm do you want to take? Do you want to eat Burger King or McDonald's? Same owner in the background. There's an illusion of an option. So.
Yes, correct. And you know, I'm so glad, you know, again, you know, that you who were born in Denmark, who are looking at our country and sort of underlying all of these agendas, if you will, and you're correct. I mean, most people here do not understand that we really are in a police, what I refer to as a police state. They don't even realize we're in it. We're under surveillance. And we are in a police state, meaning all laws can be broken, arrests can be made without warrants. Many laws have been passed that are very unfair to the United States citizens. And what's sad is the United States citizens don't even know that literally, if someone wanted to come to your home, kick open your front door, and I mean somebody out of the police or the military, kick in your front door, shoot you dead, there would be no repercussion on the police force or the police state that we're in or the government or the military. It's happening. And I'm seeing reports like this almost on a daily basis. I have one you don't have to answer this because I know we're running short on time. But somebody from the chat room said, you know, does Roxy have any belief that Lennon was killed because what he was about to tell all? And then she mentioned, or he mentions, that Paul McCartney was killed in 1966 and a replacement followed circa 1966. All I have to say to that is it's a story for another day, Gerber. And if you want, I will get somebody, and ironically, Ole, out of Denmark, somebody I've known for 30 plus years who has covered the whole Paul McCartney was killed in 1966. And it's fascinating and it's creepy. But if you want to make a comment on that, that's fine. Or if you want to continue, that's fine as well.
I tell you, there's a lot about this thing as well. I must say, it's incredible when you start looking into these things. But I for one as well, when you look into the facts again, it sounds really off the head to start with. But when you look into the facts, Paul McCartney died in 1966, and this guy who's walking around now is not the real one. But that is not so important that he's fake. But the important thing is why. Why did they do this cover-up, and how did they get away with it? What was the reason? And this is also one of the things that might be connected to why George Harrison was stabbed almost to death, and how John Lennon was killed when he was killed, because it is said that he was just about to go public with this secret as well. But I would prefer to go back to what we were talking about before. I think when you're talking about your country, I would say that please study history. Study history, and what you will see is not a very nice picture, because when you look upon what's happening in the States, what has happened since 9/11 and forward, and also been going on for many, many years. What we're looking at, if you compare to the Third Reich under Hitler, there's the similarities are frightening because they're following the same template as there as well. And it sounds, once again, off the head if you're not really, really well informed about history. But when you start seeing that the same power elite goes back generations back, and they were part of funding Hitler, the Hitler war machine. They were part of exporting super Nazis, thousands of them, in what is called Operation Paperclip after the Second World War, when the Nazi war machine was dead, at least it was conquered. That was what people thought. But what happened was that instead especially the states imported all of these Nazis, and they were part of creating the OSS, which later turned into CIA. They were also part of creating the NASA, and they were part of creating the whole banker system in the states and so on. So the same people are the one that did this are the ones in power now. And if you ask me, what is called the New World Order could also be called the Fourth Reich, because it's the same mentality and also the same families and the same people who are pushing this forward on us. And if I can just say about these mass shootings, the reason for these mass shootings, and lately, I don't know how many of the latest ones, they are not even happening. I mean, they're actually using actors nowadays. There's especially from one website called crisisactors.org. You can apply there for becoming one of the actors. It's absolutely incredible. And I think the
What's it
reason,
called? Crisis
crisisactors.org,
actors.org.
crisisactors.org.
Unbelievable. And yes, you're right. The Boston Marathon, I think this is what made a lot of conspiracy theorists, they devoured, no, I'm sorry, Sandy Hook. And apparently there were so many actors, like, women and children. And you made a very good point when you were talking about the whole method, the template. The part about the women and children are getting to your heart, getting to the heart of the people. You're absolutely right, because imagine you're going down the rabbit hole, right? And you start looking at the Sandy Hook supposed victims of families and children's, et cetera. And then you look at some other pictures that come out the paper 2 days later, and those are different. And wait a minute, who are those people? I thought those were the same, the Smiths. The Smiths had blonde hair. How come now they have brown hair, or whatever it is? You said it. They're getting sloppy. And imagine you start telling the world, or at least people around you, that it's all fake and these are all actors. Even 9/11 is very hard for people to swallow. People get humanitarian side switches on and says, "How dare you start to belittle or say these terrible things? People lost their children, people lost their families, their loved one, their loved ones. How could you say that this was just a staged, hiring of actors in Hollywood setup?" You're right. They're really good at what they do, aren't they?
Yeah, but they're getting very sloppy, like I said, which I mean, I think the reason why they started using actors was because, like I said before, every time you blow someone up or you kill someone, you start having a major problem, because especially mothers, if their children get killed, they will be on your case from that day on. They will not back off, and they will never quit until they found out what actually happened to their child. And so if you do that on a regular basis, and you get hundreds and hundreds of, or like in 9/11, thousands of people killed, you have a massive problem. So I think that is why, one of the reasons why they started with actors, because at least they can keep it sort of to a small group of people. And these act, but they're getting so clumsy that they're using the same actors even, so you have like one in the Boston bombing, like there was one girl, a woman that had half of her body was blown away. And then you see in one of the interviews, she's sitting behind the guy being interviewed a few hours later. Or you got the headmaster in Sandy Hook. Suddenly she's the same picture, the same woman with a different name is one of the witnesses at the who heard one of some of the bombs blowing off, and she was killed in Sandy Hook. I mean, go explain that. You got the same police chief, the same name, same hat, everything, but in different states. And he's in different at these different bomb sites. You got the same. It's the same. It's the same. It's the same. And I think one of the reasons they use these actors is because they with a small group of people, they can control them more. But like I'm saying, it's getting really sloppy and low budget and really, really bad. So the
Do you think
next
that's
time.
because it's also only that the frequency of these reports and these
Rock, you blocked out there.
I can't hear her, but the I would say that the reason.
No, go ahead. Go ahead. Oh, can you hear me now, Ole? Sorry. It goes out on me for about 20 seconds at a time throughout the entire shows, about every 7 seconds. So I have to kind of piecemeal the show together. But go ahead. Go on. Just keep talking. Go ahead.
I tell you, Roxy, just like you said, when you talk about these things, there's so many times you've got unexpected technical problems. I don't know what's going on.
Yes, I have unexpected friends that just kind of show up in the room, right? And so they're welcome too. You know, maybe it just but they're welcome to be here too. I was going to ask you if you can hear me. Do you think they're getting sloppy? One of the reasons could be because the frequency in which this mayhem and chaos, these stories, went from like one tragedy in a year that was really big and wow to like every day.
Yeah, but this is the thing. I believe that they know that the game is over because there's such an awakening going on, and I'm super positive when it comes to the future. I think that they're getting really freaked out, and what they try to do is with these mass shootings is they try to point at the weapons, saying these are the problem. We're back to problem, reaction, solution. It's not that somebody is crazy and shoots people. No, it's the weapons. And what they want is to get the reaction from people saying, my God, we need to get rid of the weapons. And what they want is for you to put down the guns. The reason why these mass shootings are happening only in the States, more or less, is because you are the only population that are armed and will not just lie down and be walked over. Because if you do that, I'm not one that stands up for violence. On the contrary, I totally believe in the Mahatma Gandhi, Martin Luther King way, to stand up, do not bend, but stand up and do not hit back, but do not bend either. But I tell you, if you give up these guns, they will just take over. So these mass shootings are to get you to give up your guns. And I would just say, do not do that, because the people who are trying to do that, I'm just going to very quickly say the people in this power pyramid, in the top, I'm not the absolute top, because I don't know so much about the absolute top. I've go to a way up there and one level that I really studied in details. There are three main groups there. It's the Trilateral Commission, it's the Council on Foreign Relations, and it's the Bilderberg Group. The people in these three groups are, many of them are members in the same group, in more than one. But these are the ones that are pushing forward this agenda on normal people. So it's crucial to find out who these people are and also find out the agenda. And one of the things in the ebook of my coup d'etat in slow motion that can be bought on my website is that the last 200 pages is memberships list of these organizations. And you will just, if you don't know it before, it will be mind-blowing for you to see these people, because these are handpicked people from many, many Western countries, if not all of them, that together makes a spider web, an invisible power ghost government, of shadow government of the world, that are pushing this agenda on us without us knowing it. So once again, it's time to wake up. This is not a time to change channel and check out another football game. This is the time for humanity to stand up for what is right and true. And let's build a future on love and compassion and forgiveness. But first, this needs to be exposed. This madness needs to be stopped by us waking up. Because it's only when we're sleeping that this can carry on. They're just a small group of people with a lot of high tech on their hands. But otherwise than that, it's just like the Wizard of Oz. You know, you stand up in
yes.
You are not afraid. What's her name? Dorothy and the other one. They dare to enter this palace. And there's this scary, scary voice saying, I'm powerful and you're weak. You should be afraid, afraid, afraid. But they, even though they're scared, they don't back off. They continue forward. And what do they find? A little old guy behind a curtain with a massive amplifier and a microphone saying, I'm powerful. Same story here. these are mostly old guys that, you know, in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and they're controlling us. It's an absolute joke. But it's through these people, especially people in uniform, and also people, the staff of FEMA camps and these things, wake up and see whose agenda you're supporting. Because it's incredible what's going on. It's absolute madness. And it's time to stop it. We need to wake up.
Absolutely. Ole, I just want to thank you so much. And please come and visit with us again. There's so much more to talk about. The book is Coup d'etat in slow motion by my guest, Ole Dammegard. Again, thank you so much. He says the last 200 pages are a list of all